everybody to the pop-up exhibition series at the Magnes. This happens every week on Wednesday. We started at 12:15 sharp, so it is 12:15. And we essentially have an ongoing format of uniting a presenter, either from campus or the community, with objects from the Magnes collection, one of the largest Jewish music collections in the world. And today's presenter is a partner in crime, John Voss, and you see one of his many creations and the one he's working on a lot these days, HistoryPin, on the screen behind us. Actually, just to make sure that we know that this is a community, I remember, it must have been like 2007, 2008, my then colleague James Leventhal, who happens to be in the audience today, just arrived, who is moving on to being Director of Development at San Jose Museum of Art, right? So congratulations. So James pinged me and said, you know, there's this guy who's doing this crazy thing, and it's called Look Back Maps. And it was actually an iPhone app and a website, and you could navigate, you could explore the history of San Francisco, navigating from the present back into the past through images and use augmented reality and history all at once, and it was really brilliant. And we started corresponding, and I remember, John, you were very excited because we were pushing Magnes content on social media, we're using Flickr, we're sort of pioneering the use of Flickr for cultural heritage at the time. And we were actually working very carefully at geolocating the images, so whenever we posted images online, we also put them on a map so that people like you could play with them and do things. And so it's been, in a way, a partnership over the years, and John is an amazing, sort of like a here in person, but like an intercontinental digital treasure in these many endeavors. So it's really a pleasure to have him here. This is also one of our Digital Humanities talks as part of both the weekly pop-up exhibitions, but also the project The Future of Memory. If you haven't visited the gallery next door, I encourage you to do so. We hosted Digital Humanities talks in the spring. We highlighted different platforms, Findery, and I see John Fox in the back there, so the community continues to be engaged. And then we talked about the pop-up archive and the idea of archiving sound and what to do with digital sound. So today, I guess our starting point is digital history and local and global history. So just want to begin with, point you to our display, and I invite you, essentially whenever you want, to come up and take a closer look. One of the oldest congregations in San Francisco in the 1800s, inaugurated a new synagogue building on Bush Street in 1895. And when they did so, they placed in the cornerstone of the building, and the building is still standing, they placed a time capsule. And this time capsule was eventually retrieved in 2001, and as you can see, kind of using some form of a can opener. It was opened up, and this is some of the contents of the time capsule. And you see that it's, you know, from, you know, technology of the time to coins to mementos to all kinds of organizational records of the congregation itself that emerged from this time capsule. And we've been playing with this online in a variety of ways, and it's a perfect candidate for the type of work that John does. So I felt that it would be a nice link between the extremely digital world that you live in and that you make happen every day, and the analog responsibilities that we continue to have to history. So I thought that would be a good start, but maybe a starting point. I don't know how much you get to do this, to just give us a little bit of a digital autobiography. I don't know if the Look Back Maps project is a good one to start from, but at least that's when we met, but maybe there is more to retrieve in this type of history. So it's history of digital history.
Right. Well, I don't know if this is going to work.
Yes.
All right. Hey, everyone. Hopefully everyone can hear me. I'll try and speak into this. Well, so I think it's a great, and for all these years that we've been working, you've been a really good kind of co-thinker with me on these things, too, and trying to figure out what it means for us for a community. So myself, I have And I'm, you know, I don't get a whole lot of chance to talk about my past, I guess, because I'm focused on the communal past. But I have kind of a 5-year career attention span, as you may know. So when I met you, I was an IT consultant at the time, and I was just, you know, really interested in time travel. And I knew that if we could get enough old photos of the mission, I'd be able to envision what that looked like and walk around and see it. So it was a pretty selfish motive, and I happened to have some extra developer time and some, you know, I had a team of guys who I could pull into this. And that's where Look Back Map was born out of, Look Back Maps. And that was about 2009 when we finally got that going. And what I realized pretty quickly was that all I was doing was creating another closed database, right? So we were trying to get all these photos and all this metadata from all kinds of other collections so that we could do things with it. But then I was just taking that a step further, putting it into my database so I could do what I wanted to do with it. And that got us thinking, well, maybe we could do something even bigger and figure out a way that everybody could open up things and share things in a way that we didn't have to put it in one place. So that was kind of the beginning of starting to think about linked open data. And at that time, and this idea of linked open data is basically that cultural heritage institutions, or anyone for that matter, can share their data in a way that other people can use it and access it. It requires some technology, but it also requires open licensing and a number of things that politically were not really happening in the library, archive, museum world, or they were just, as you said, you were at the forefront of that.
Well, the attitude was actually that of hoarding and being really scared that if cultural heritage collections put content online, somebody would come and steal it.
Yeah.
Right? So there was really a barrier to that.
Right.
So it was also, it was not just about opening data, but very much about opening minds.
Totally, yeah. And I think Look Back Maps, and there are a number of other projects that were starting to happen then. John, you were doing stuff with Memory Miner at the time, and you know, there were a lot of really cool projects. And also it was at that time where we were all starting to be on cell phones, on smartphones particularly, so that everything was kind of geolocated. So you can start to say, well, here's a real interest, like I want to know what's in this place. And for me as a history nerd, I just wanted to know what used to be in this place. And that's really what we were looking to do. And I think a lot of libraries, archives started to say, wait a minute, here's a great use case for our collections. And we don't have to build it, other people are going to build it. Maybe there's something to this. So at that time, we got together a few people. And I happened to run into a guy, Jason Douglas, who was then at MetaWeb, which started this company, or a project called Freebase, or the horribly named Freebase, which was this idea of a database.
Oh my god, I just got that now.
What? Yeah. So those guys, in turn, were bought by Google. So, you know, but anyway, they had this idea of linked data and how you could do this. And they were doing it with music databases, they were doing it with other things, not really cultural heritage, because there was no money in that. But then we started to get this idea, this picture of what could happen. And then we created a project called Linked Open Data. It was for Civil War Data 150. That was another digital project that I started. It didn't really go anywhere. It was more of a concept. And we put that in for a National Endowment for the Humanities grant. And when they got it, the reviewers, half of them were like, this is awesome, we gotta do it. Half of the reviewers were like, what in the hell are they talking about? And so what we realized is we needed to start talking about this as a community. What is linked open data? What are the potentials? What can we do with this? And at that point, we convened the first international meeting on linked open data in libraries, archives, and museums. Now, the thing that I saw today, by the way, just to jump to the present time, is there was a New York Times article today. I don't know if you saw this, but it was about linked open data in archives and museums. And so I feel like, here we are, we've come full circle. Now we've got this critical mass. Now, you know, you see so many institutions around the world saying, yeah, let's do this, let's put this stuff out there. And now we're starting to see people like Eric Kanza here, who's an archaeologist. I'm gonna call out each one of you in turn in the audience. There's a small enough group of us, I think we could. You know, I sat down with him the other day with a contingent from Australia, and they were interviewing him, and he was telling me, and I can't do it justice, you know, I might have to pass the mic to you, but this idea of taking all this information about archaeological digs, then sharing that data now in a way that you couldn't do 5 years ago with zoologists, with biologists, and starting to track the history of, you know, how animals have changed, or this was animal husbandry, right? So how breeded animals kind of moved across Europe. But this is something that you couldn't even have done 5 years ago, and this is what you can do with cultural heritage data. So it's not just time travel, it's actually looking, trying to figure out the mystery of our universe. So I get for Clint.
It's great to have you here, John. And as we know, there's a lot more to explore. But it's good to have a little bit of your own history into this. Yeah. And then at some point, you get looped into this other project.
That's right.
Pin, right?
So the HistoryPin crew, they were looking to launch in, so they started in beta in 2010, and they were going to do their big US or their big world launch in San Francisco. So when they were starting to work with institutional partners, libraries, archives, museums, they were saying, could you share your data? We've got this project. And everybody was like, John Voss has already been here and talked to us about this. You know, like, it's already done. And they're like, well, we don't work with them. And so finally they came to me and said, you know, well, maybe we should work together. And I really loved the social mission that they had from the start. I mean, so I was doing it just kind of for my own personal mind travel. HistoryPin, and what I really loved about it was doing it to really create intergenerational conversations. And that's since very much evolved. You know, how do we have stronger communities through our shared local history? And that's what HistoryPin's all about. We just relaunched, in fact, last week. This is the first time that any of us have talked about it publicly. We've been doing it, you know, on the web and whatnot. But we now have this kind of renewed focus of how we can have these community conversations. So not like you have something like this, the analog thing, but what does that tell us about community, and what can we add to that conversation? You know, not just we can discover and we can see it, but what does that tell us about ourselves? And so that's something that we're really, really interested in trying to kind of continue down that path. So
from a cursory kind of exploration, there isn't too much difference in the concept between what you were doing before HistoryPin with your look back maps and HistoryPin itself. The surface is images. It's a very image based concept, mm-hmm. and mapped images,
right.
And then a chronological sort of like a time traveling possibility.
Yeah.
And then the augmented reality, whether it's augmented reality, is the use of Google Street Views to see it, you know, a place how it looks now, or at least the last time that the Google car went through that street and photographed it. So what is the real difference to you in sort of moving from your own project to a global one that seemingly seems to be doing the same thing, but it's also not? So what is the main difference there?
Well, on one hand, it's scale. You know, like when you're working on a project that's, well, it's a couple things to that, right? Look Back Maps was a project that I hoped could be of value to institutions, and I had to figure out a way to pay for it. As many of us know who worked, you know, independently, you have to figure out how you're going to pay the bills as well. And so I thought that was something that we could scale with museums and cultural heritage institutions. But what turned out to be the case is that really what we're looking at was something much bigger, that it required a cultural, political change for these institutions. So that's one thing, is just the scale of it, right? Like that we really, there was a need here for community. And I think there are, obviously, there's museum communities, there's conferences, there's library conferences, etc. But there wasn't this sense that we could do this together. In fact, a lot of the cultural heritage institutions, to me, have been pretty trapped by vendors, because there's not a ton of money in that space. I mean, unless you're talking about big art museums or things like this, you know, your local cultural heritage, your local history institution, whatever, they don't have a ton of money. So they have pretty limited options of what they can do. So if we could build this stuff together, that's one big change. The other for me with HistoryPin is that it gives us the ability to really focus on the people, which is not the digital side of it at all. In fact, what you see on a lot of the digital elements of HistoryPin is just the tip of the iceberg. The ideal is to have the conversations. And I want to pick on this book here. So this is our friend Paul, who put together this book of his photos, his father's photos, right? And this is, I mean, it's fascinating. When I saw somebody hand me this book, and it was a teacher instructor. And so these are photos from, starting from 1930s, right? Or later, 1959 is the first. And each of them, to me, it was interesting. Cause, so these are, this is social change in action. You know, like this is seeing labor rights, farm immigration issues, the war, protests against the war, etc. These are some of the stories that we don't really have. And what was interesting is each one had a date and a location, right? So that's where it starts for me, because I think geographically, at least we can put these things on a map. But then it gets exciting. Who was in these pictures? What is the story that they have to tell? You know, and these are archives that we start to...
Let's describe the book just for our audience. It's called Critical Focus, the Black and White Photographs of Arbutus and Richard. And this was published...
This was published by Estuary Press. When? How long ago was this?
1987.
So finally somebody gives it to me, and my first...
e-book.
And it's an e-book, that's right. Which is good. So we track down Paul, and he's like, you know, who are these crazy kids who are trying to do this thing? Well, we convinced him that it made sense to start to put these on a map. But I think what starts to get exciting now, like we have one of our interns, for instance, who's really interested in photography. We work with an organization called New Door Ventures, and they give job training to at-risk youth, basically. So she's interested in photography. We start to give her this kind of stuff, so she's learning about the issues.
Is there something you can show us?
We don't have this map yet. I'm telling you, like, cutting-edge projects
are
coming. So,
let's backtrack for a second and show us what's there now.
Okay, so we can see what's here now. So let's look a little bit. This is the way, you know, you remember everybody had... profiles on HistoryPin. So that's changed a little bit now. So it highlights some of your activity. You can say what your institution or yourself, what you're about. I just picked SFMTA here because it came to the top. And you can see your individual pins here, for instance. So you've got the same old, you know, cool, this is the 16-year-old boy test kind of thing. Like, it's relevant and it's sexy because you can put it on the street view and see what was there before. And that's always nice to kind of just have this before and after scene, which you still get.
So stop a second for those who have not seen HistoryPin in action before. So you started from a photograph from when?
So this is a photo. Scroll down. This is a night view looking north on Van Ness and Fell Street from July 1937. So. In this case, and I think in a lot of cases like this, you've got archival collections that have these amazing photographs. Most of the time, we don't really know much about what's happening on the individual level. They just have buckets and buckets of these photos. And so what they've done is they've been able to put it in a place where it was on the map, and then use Google Street View to see what it looks like now. So you can see a number, if we just kind of paste through some of these photos here, most of these actually are some famous street views. They have a ton from 1906. So not only can you see the photo, and you know this is right after the 1906 earthquake and fires, but then you can go and see what's there now. What's that look like now? And you can fade it. There's the fader disappeared on this one. Well, this is going by order of popularity. This is one of their most popular pictures. The house being moved with a streetcar going underneath. That and see what it looks like. So that's, I think, I mean, to me, just that's cool because we can start to envision what that looks like, and people can comment on that. For instance, other people have shared, you know, might share their stories about it here, saying they don't know much about this image, and people having a conversation to figure out, like, where could this be? Where is that house now? And so it's that personal interaction, which is what's really exciting to me about it. But also, could you find somebody who was there for that? I mean, in this case, probably not. This was 1913-ish. You know, but are there places where you could find those stories? Now, and speaking of people, I think of like 1913. We interviewed a woman as part of one of the projects that we talked about, Sourdough and Rye, which was focused on the San Francisco Jewish community, kind of in the Bay Area.
That we jump-started with Magnes content.
And that we used with Magnes content as well, yeah. And so we interviewed a woman a couple weeks ago who was 100 years old, and her first memory, can you imagine this, her first memory was of her dad coming home from World War I. And she was in the Alsace-Lorraine area of France, so her dad was German, her mom was French. And her dad came home from the German side after World War I. Like, that was crazy. And she was sprightly. She was ready to go. At the end of it, I asked her, like, what advice do you have for those of us who are just getting started. And she said, eat what you want, drink what you want, don't exercise, and don't waste any time. That was her thing. So, all right. And that's what brings to life.
So you were showcasing also comments and other stories. What can you tell us about the community around these? Who gets engaged?
Yeah.
And how do you know who gets engaged? I just, for full disclosure, and this is a good term, I just came from a conference on campus about manufacturing transparency and the whole idea of privacy and how much of our own information we give to social media. So what do you know, since I'm sure you're studying your audience, what do you know about who's engaged with this?
Well, so one of the things we know, we've got about 67,000 members. That's people who have started accounts on HistoryPin over the last 5 years. Of those, about 2,600 or so are cultural heritage institutions. And here, we've actually started to see things that we hadn't seen before, just sorting the profiles by popularity. And most of these have either been around for a while, one, or they were on HistoryPin when we first got started. Or they have a ton of content, so you can see the Library of Virginia, 771.
So you can see on the right is the pin, so it's the individual item of content that you have on the platform, and on the left are the views, so how popular they are, how many times that content is clicked upon.
That's right. So that's how this list is sorted, and so naturally a lot of institutions come up on here. So they're getting a lot of local traffic. It's a way to view their collections in a way that most of the public hadn't seen yet. So that's where a lot of the stuff comes from. But at the same time, well, this is a good example. This guy, his name is Danny, the Pottery's Tile Trail, and he's had over 15,000 views. He only has 391 pins. So like National Archives has, you know, 1,000 or 2,000. SF Public Library has probably 2,000 or 3,000 at this point. This guy's passion is tiles that were made that, like, I don't know, pottery tiles. I don't know anything about this. But it's, you know, like, you can see the pictures. They're amazing things that you might not notice if you're not into this kind of thing, I guess. But if you walk down a street like this in somewhere in the UK, in London, you notice that the tiles all up above are handmade pottery tiles. And this guy, his expertise, his passion, is knowing which kilns made which tiles and where they are. And so he actually leads walking tours around the UK, around London, I guess, from London, somewhere. And he's just been in love with this because he's able to now do this for free. You know, map it, put his map on here, map some of the kilns, map where this thing will come from. So those are kind of our core users. They're what we call, cultural heritage activists. I think that's what Brendan, our ED, our executive director, calls them, right? So he's looking for people that have a passion about a place or a passion about a topic and can gather community around that. And that's a lot of what this new version of HistoryPin is about, providing those tools. And I would call it Donna here in the front row. She's one of our superstars. So she kind of sees this need for gathering community around historical places. So one of the projects that she's done called East at Main Street is about the Asian Pacific Islander communities and kind of saying, okay, you've got Chinatown, Filipino town, Japan town, whatever they may be, why are these places important? What happened? And so she's actually going around the country, meeting with these organizers and saying, tell us what's important, let's put this up and share it. So these community organizers are really the key of who some of our
members are. And of course, cultural heritage institutions. And we actually, we have Mary Ellen's here, who's been collaborating with you with the Bancroft Library, and next week Mary will be presenting in the series. So, but how do you connect with institutions? What's the motivator there, and how do you have to pitch it? Are you approached by them? Probably a mixed bag. But if you can share some case studies.
Well, it used to be that we had to pitch them, and I think at some point we kind of got critical mass, so we were able to. People know who we are. We've gone to, you know, we did our rounds doing conferences for a long time. But eventually people started to see that this is something that we were building in community with them. And so now, for the most part, we don't really do any kind of outreach except for to talk about our projects. And institutions tend to come to us at this point. I won't say, I mean, Mary knows, we've been talking to Bancroft since day one too, it was like, all right, this guy needs to calm down. but now we finally got to a point where next week we're going to work with them. Next week, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, when is that?
November 19th,
in which they're going to add some 1,000 or 2,000 photos to this project called Mapping San Francisco's 1915 World's Fair. So again, they have all this great content about a specific place and time, but we need the help of the community to help map those. And so what's really cool about this project is, this is the, it was called the Panama Pacific International Expo. And this is the first time that we were able to take a historical map, because it happened for this 1 year, you know, we were able to create these map tiles that show you actually what this fairground looks like. And there are literally thousands of photos of what this was. Now, I mean, this gives you a sense of, you know, World's Fair in San Francisco in 1915. It took up the entire marina from the bridge, before the bridge was there, all the way to Fort Mason. Fort Mason was there at that time. And then you can go in and see some of the crazy exhibits in the zone. Some of these actually killed people, these historical rides. Some of them were an actual scale model of the Panama Canal, which had just opened. Let's see what else we see as we walk. Here's the kind of overview of the fairgrounds themselves. You got insane racist exhibits, like slumming in Chinatown. So, and we can kind of bring these things to life and explore them. And so, what's interesting from the institutional side now, and they have hundreds of these photos, or thousands of these photos as the case may be, we really need help. They don't have the resources to actually just go and put them on the map or put them on the street view. And what's cool about it is we can have fun doing it together. And so there's this social element of history to us here. And then I'm going to show you one more thing about this, if I can, because my favorite part of this, you know, in my time travels here, I fell in love with these two statues, the Fountain of the Rising Sun and the Fountain of the Setting Sun. And these two are just the most amazing images. If I can find them. Well, that's when it's working. So this is what happens when you start to share your collections. And I'm gonna see if we can play this thing here. This is actually a computer simulation that somebody took using all this is at Ball State University, using a lot of these images, using the architectural drawings that people had, and created this simulation. And they also had a 3D, you know, full round, whatever, imagery of the actual statues themselves. So you can go and see this. These statues now are at the Smithsonian. But you can't hear it, but there's a fountain noise there. I wasn't thinking I was going to show the fountain sounds, but anyway, so you see these amazing statues, and you see this whole world. So that's what, like, come on, we're getting to time travel now, we're getting there, and you can see it at night. So they're using all this sophisticated computer modeling to teach the, you know, the power of computer modeling, but what it does for other people is it gives you a sense of what was happening there. What did this feel like to be there? And that was actually done like 4 or 5 years ago.
Why Ball State? Do you know what the connection is?
I have no idea. It's a, like a computer programming thing. And this was done probably 4 years ago or so. So I actually found it on the internet.
So one of the key concepts that seems to emerge from pretty much everything, and it's now time to also open it up for comments and requests, but it seems to emerge from everything you've been presenting is that history is here presented and conceived as a collaborative project, essentially.
Yeah.
Right?
That's
it. It's not a mono, you know, one voice, a single voice speaking, or, you know, historians are in various levels, whether they're institutions, individuals, as you call them, history nerds, but now you have a fancier way to call them too, right? But everyone sort of ends up collaborating in one way or another, and so this type of platform encourages that and exists through that.
Yeah.
And it's the same sort of philosophy also behind linked open data, so it, in a way, that's possibly one of the key threads. So how do you, I mean, some of this happened somewhat spontaneously, because we are now at this point, we're all used to social media. platforms, and people are used to adding comments and liking things and sharing them, etc. But how do you encourage that? If you, do you need to encourage that, or how do you build that? In other words, what happens outside of the screen and outside of the web?
Yeah.
What do you see happening?
So, well, first of all, I think I'm just kind of looking at some of these projects or examples. So what I've been working on kind of in my head lately is that the World Wide Web changed everything. It changed how we work together, how we relate to one another. And it brought about, kind of technologically, but also culturally, this concept that we can build things together. Like, we're not reliant on top-down structure, that we actually have the power to do this ourselves. And I think, to me, HistoryPin is one of those examples where we can create a tool that anyone can use to tell their story. And historians can use that. And I think there's some tension there, actually, between kind of the step, like, traditional historians who are looking at all kinds of records and they're looking at things in certain ways. I'm not a historian. I don't know exactly what they do. Versus people who are telling their own side of the story, right? And so there's something that's not exclusive anymore about that. That power is a little bit taken away from it. But it still gives historians something that they can do, something that they can find, something that they can use in this thing. So I absolutely think that we see this not only in history and cultural heritage, we see it in religion and politics, everywhere else, that we're trying to grapple with what it means to live in a society post-web or in the era of the web or the age of the web, whatever it is. So I think that has huge implications for all of us. You know, I think you see it here, you see it, you know, with the Sourdough Rye Project, we work with a lot of the Jewish communities and temples. They're looking at that. What does our digital presence look like? What is it, you know, how does that look like physically? I'm on the board of San Francisco Zen Center, and we grapple with that quite a bit there too. What is this, you know, what is community look like in this age of the web? It's no longer limited to clicks. So it's an exciting time. But I do think it is that is a huge paradigm shift that we're still grappling with today.
Thank you. We definitely have time for questions and remarks.
It's encyclopedia.
Encyclopedia, interesting.
Because it, as opposed to something purporting to give you the scoop, instead it just is like all these doors and windows and ways for people to look at something. Infinite ways. And which to me sounds like a big improvement. After watching, you know, my granddaughter, you know, or grandson, you know, like they're doing reports and you know, so it's sort of like the encyclopedia.
That's an interesting thought. I wonder if just thinking out loud about it with Wikipedia, that Wikipedia is the idea of people coming to a consensus of knowledge in a way, right? And everybody contributing their thing. You're getting things reported on that might not appear or make the cut in any kind of traditional encyclopedia. But there is a level of consensus. And I think you're right that with this, it's a way for anyone to tell their story or tell a take on a story or just to start with something that we just don't know anything about. It's this photo that I found. And I can tell by the picture that's in this place, what story does that tell us? It's a good point.
I wonder if there can be an emotional
element
to this.
Absolutely.
That it could be developed because the technology takes out the human, and this says to me that it's beautiful.
I think that's a really good point, actually. And it's when, you know, I've done a lot of those. I lost both my parents this year, and I've, you know, they were my guinea pigs on a lot of these projects, of course. And now I can go back to those and see those stories and see, you know, what it looked like to be in that place or to have had the opportunity to ask some questions of what were you thinking then. And that's exactly what you're talking about, that personal element of it that brings these things to life and makes meaning and creates impact.
When you call yourself history, looking at your website, it's a very excellent means of
Yeah, that's right. So in the, I would say the time slider is a little bit buggy right now. In fact, I've just seen some cool designs that they're working on to change that. So this just takes us to Berkeley, and you can see we've got all these photos of Berkeley. They show up in a collection view on the right side here. All kinds of cool tour. See, this is what's interesting. Like, I didn't even know these things existed, and that's the fun thing about this thing, too, because now collections come up on top. So here's the Albany Library. It's done 4th of July through the years. So that shows up, and I can go in and check out this specific collection. It'll take a minute to load. But that's awesome. I didn't even know that was there. But yeah, so you can also filter down by time. And right now, it doesn't. What it should be doing is it should be showing you the oldest and the newest photo in this. And it goes all the way back to 1000. Eric, you'll be excited about that. Because we are starting to do some experiments around where we start to limit that time and what it is you can start to map. So if we just look at maybe anything before 1933. So now you can see anything that happened before 1933. Although this one is World War II, which should be remembered. But yeah, that's so the time slider does give you that extra ability to at least in theory.
And you can put a map of anywhere the Google Map has a map, or where it's got a collection, or what?
You can map anything. You can go anywhere in the world, and this is a global project. So, and this is, I've actually been testing this by just trying to think of towns and seeing if there's pins there. So anyone, name a town. Name a town.
Pendle.
What?
Pendle.
Pendle?
Yeah.
How do you spell it?
P-E-N-D-L-E.
L-E? Is that California? Oregon? No, Pendle? That place is too small to even be a place name. Come on. So next name. Come on.
Carborough,
all right. Carborough, North Carolina.
Paris of the Piedmont.
Carborough, North Carolina. There it is. Let's see if the name is there. There are some things here. Stuff to come up. Everything you want to know about sex. Of course I'm going to click on that.
Wait, can you scroll that? Hold that picture then. One moment.
Do you want to do a selfie with it?
No. Come here, John.
Yes. Of course. Yes.
You're right.
That's it. Okay, thank you for your contribution, John Fox. Always precious.
Oh, look at it on the street view there. See, it's over here and over here.
So how do these things show up without you knowing about it?
Well, because people are adding it. It's a completely crowdsourced thing.
You could just add it, go on the website and say, I want to add this, and then put your picture up there.
Absolutely. And I mean, for the most part, it's really good stuff. I mean, we are looking at things as they come in. And I'm sure.
You look at things as they come in.
Yeah, so we're seeing them, and this might be inappropriate or not. I mean, it's amazing how much of it blurs the line, you know? And you have to ask yourself, is this historic or not? Or
so you have the right to tell them no.
Yeah, we can take things off. We try not to, though, you know? And part of it is just, like, you might get a picture of two people in a bar from last week, and it's on a map where that bar is. And, like, you know, is this, and people are like, this is not historical. Well, A, you could use the time slider to see things that are older. But the other side of it is, it would be historical if that building wasn't here tomorrow, you know, for sure. You see a lot of, you know, I had my picture on top of the Twin Towers, right? And I didn't really think much about that picture until the towers were gone. And now that starts to mean something. So yeah, there's a lot of filters that we can use to think about that.
John?
Is this stuff getting archived in repositories, in digital repositories?
Yeah, it's a good question. So it is not right now. One of our projects called Memories of Migration, which is working on basically public libraries, working with teen historians to do oral histories of new immigrants. That's our first program in which we are working on long-term preservation for all the user-generated content. So we're working on that with DPLA, the Digital Public Library of America, and with Internet Archive as well. We have another project in the UK that's working with the British Library. So you think of StoryCorps, for instance. Every time you do a StoryCorps report, anything on sort of StoryCorps, except the oral history interview project, they give a CD to the Library of Congress, and that's cataloged there. So most of the institutional collections obviously are part of a long-term collection, but it's the user-generated content that we're starting to figure out how to preserve.
And the metadata, of course.
And the metadata. And in fact, and we had a good conversation about this not long ago, right? Like, would you, as an institution, want to preserve this stuff, right? And that was some tough questions around what what preservation institutions are able to accession.
And I think another interesting and tough question is the issue of ownership. Because this content is all uploaded to your server, right? To the HistoryPin server. So in a way, HistoryPin becomes the custodian of this. And also the owner.
We don't become the owner. We're the digital custodian of it, yes, but we do not take any copyright or ownership.
Okay.
So when you share your photos, and we thought about this a little bit, is you can choose what license you give it. So you can say this is, you know, public domain, or you can use any of the Creative Commons licenses, for instance, or you can say it's all rights reserved. And in fact, I put up a lot of stuff that I see on the web, and I give credit to the photographer and say it's all rights reserved, but I'll put it on the map. And we take no ownership over that at all. The key is, and this is part of something that we'd like to do more of, is educating people on how you cite your resources so that you could put up any content. In fact, that's really what I started with Back Maps with, was taking photos from institutions and just putting them up on there, but making sure to cite them.
So there was a check, can you use this photo as a historical document in research?
So that's a good question. So let's take a look. If we go into any photo, for instance, Flower Ladies of Chapel Hill, you should see on the bottom right a license called, this one says no known copyright restrictions. It tells us when it was added to the site. The photo is in the 1950s, and an individual put it up, right? So this is, it's kind of, you leave it to your own decision to say, like, that one, if this is pinned by an individual and it says no known copyright restrictions, but I know that it's after 1923, meaning it's not necessarily in the public domain, I'd be dubious of that, to use it for something else. But within HistoryPin, you can use it for anything. So you could create your own collection, for instance, and you can take other people's photos. Say you wanted to make a tour of civil rights history in Berkeley. And you can take photos from the Bancroft or from the Magnus within your collection of HistoryPin. That's all protected under the terms and conditions. But then beyond that, you kind of have to think of, is it fair use, or, you know, if you're doing publishing or whatnot. Then you're in, kind of on your own territory. Those are good questions. The first one was on objects, and people have used HistoryPin for objects. I was going to try and look it up. There is one museum in North Carolina or Northern Kentucky that's done a lot of folk pottery that's been, you know, from archaeological digs. And that was one that was tricky for our staff when we started to see that these were pictures of objects. You know, and it was one that came up actually because we had never seen those before until we had this new version of HistoryPin. Like, what are all these pictures of pots? Like, this is so boring. Why would you have this? Like, hey, one person's pot is another person's
pot.
Whatever, pot. more important pot. So we are seeing some of that. The other thing that we're starting to do is play around with text. And that is another thing where it's a question of kind of what's interesting and what's not. I just want to show you real quick what text looks like now. This is a project that took 2,000 Victorian-era novels and parsed through them for locations within London. And then they put emotional rating on what those passages might be. So now you can, for instance, you can browse through Charles Dickens' London by passages, which is really interesting. It doesn't, from a kind of aesthetic perspective, it doesn't look that cool, but from an academic perspective, or just from, like, imagine having Sherlock's London on here, that would be pretty cool for me. I wasn't really interested in Victorian London, but when I started to go to London with this map, with this is an 1895 map with these passages, it started to bring London to life in a new way for me, which is really cool. And your other question, working with, we are starting to work with a lot of tribal libraries, and particularly around archaeological digs, and with local tribes around the world, First Nations, Maori, New Zealand, there's huge level of concerns there that HistoryPin does not deal with at this point, which we need to look at. And we work with our colleagues at Mukido, you may have heard of, Kim and the team over there, and there's someone in Berkeley too, right?
That was
going to
be one of my other questions.
Yeah, so they're specifically looking at all the levels of permissions that you need to examine and work with tribes.
What are they?
So, for instance, well, you can probably talk more to it than I can, but basically there are certain things that you can't see if you're not an elder, or there are artifacts and remains that are often photographed during digs or archaeological things, or sacred sites that they don't want people to know where they are. So there's a number of other concerns. In cultural heritage in general, we don't talk about it much in the U.S., but we just kind of talk about moral rights as well as copyrights and things like this. So there's several levels.
Thank you. I think we mission accomplished.
Yeah,
thank you so much, John.
Thanks for having me.
Being here, and thank you, everybody.